Welcome to Hindu Analysis, August 27, 2018. So today we are going to see all these articles. So the first article is Council Conundrum, which means what is the confusion existing in the establishment of state legislative councils in all the states. So whether every state should have state legislative council or not, that is what this article deals with. So what the news here is, the Odisha government wants to join the group of states that is having an upper house. So only out of 29, 7 states have bicameral legislature, which means it has both legislative assembly as well as the legislative council. So now Odisha is also want to join in that list. So what the recent news is, the state cabinet of Odisha government recently approved for the establishment of such SLC, which is the state legislative council, which include 49 members. So what is the process for the establishment of this SLC is, it is a two-step process. One is the first step is the state assembly of the respective state should have to pass a resolution which needs majority of its total membership. So once the state assembly passes the resolution, then it is going to parliament, and the parliament has to enact a separate law for the establishment of this SLC. So this is the process. So what is the one more concern here is, still now there are two bills are pending in Rajya Sabha, which is started in 2013, which requires SLC, which should be established in both Assam as well as the Rajasthan. But in these both states, not at these SLCs are getting established, which means that there is a lack of support for such establishment, which raises a question that establishment of such SLC is really benefiting for the state or not, whether this SLC in every state, right? So it is beneficial really for the people or for the society or not. That is what the major question. And if yes, that means if the establishment is useful, then why we are having only 7 councils as of now? This is also a question. So if you see here, Jammu and Kashmir, Uttar Pradesh, Bihar, Maharashtra, Telangana, Andhra Pradesh and Karnataka. These are the 7 states which is having bicameral legislature, which means both SLC and the SLA. So for this, what the parliamentary committee suggested is there should be a national policy, which is universal policy, for which is valid all over the country in case of establishment of such SLC in every state. Okay, because establishment of such common national policy is needed if any party fails in the election, then the next party comes into power, then they are obviously going to eliminate or eradicate such SLC which is formed by the previous government. In order to avoid that, we should have a common policy. It should be national or universal. So that is what the parliamentary committee suggested first, which means the policy should be framed by the union government so that the subsequent government in that state doesn't abolish it. And second one is the provision in the law. That means there should be an explicit mentioning of the reservation of the seats for both the graduates as well as the teachers. This is also needed. This is what the parliamentary committee suggested in case of this establishment of SLCs. But now we have a question, why we need upper house? So we are having Rajya Sabha in case of center as the upper house and SLC in case of state levels as an upper house. So why we need upper house means there are 4 important reasons. One is the upper house is considered as a forum of intellectuals as well as the academicians. So it contains a well innovative mind which is contributing to the efficient governance of a country or a state. Similarly, this upper house provides mechanism for sober legislation that a state may pass. So if a state or a center is dealing with any kind of sensitive legislation, then this upper house can provide some efficient mechanism in order to tackle that. So this is also one of the advantage of having an upper house in both center as well as in the state level. And also this upper house is usually a representation of the states. This upper house doesn't have any elected members, instead it have a nominated member. So it is a representation of states and it is not a representation of electoral constituents. Only the lower house are the electoral constituencies. So this upper house acts as a force against the dominance of the elected majorities in the legislative matters. So it is to balance between both the upper house and the lower house, this upper house comes into play. But if we see whether it is really happening, that means the purpose of the upper house is really met or not in the sense. The reality is, instead of the forum which should contain the academicians and intellectuals, it is now containing the party functionaries who are not getting elected in the election. So it is a place for accommodation of the party functionaries by means of favoritism or nepotism or something. So it is a major concern. And similarly, the graduates are no longer a rarer breed in our country, because everyone is now getting graduation, everyone is now getting graduated, which means only graduation doesn't define your intellectual or your ability for the in terms of governance. And also there are enough number of teachers, professors, as well as other academic persons already in the Lok Sabha as well as in the Rajya Sabha. So then there is no need to rush up all these things. That is also a major concern. And if suppose we are already having SLA in all the states, but by means of establishing this SLC in every state, it is again going to be an unnecessary drain on the treasury or the exchequer of the particular state. So it is also have to be taken care. So what is the way forward here is, there are a lot of discussions going on about this creation, revival, as well as the abolition of these state legislative council all over the state. There is always a continuous discussion, which are inconclusive discussions, which are always going on. So there should be a cooperation, or the state and the central government should work in tandem, and the national consensus on the legislative council should be taken care. So the next article is, until dams do us part, which means this article deals with whether dams in India is a boon or a bane. So this is what we are going to see. So we all know about the recent unprecedented misery which is taking place in Kerala, which is the humongous flood as well as the human loss. So this recent tragedy in Kerala represents the dangers of excess water accumulation in dams, which is leaving behind a trail of destruction. So for knowing this intensity, to realize this intensity, you have to see this example. The recent opening of gates of the Idukki Dam, it actually triggered the Periyar River to swell rapidly, which in turn discharges nearly 7 lakh liters of water per second. So this much intensity, you should realize that if a dam is mismanaged, or if we fail to manage the dams, then what is the intensity? This is what the example. So why we usually need dam means, it is for providing the drinking water to the entire country, as well as for the agricultural purposes. So this is the basic need for the dam. But for today's society, it is scientifically improved that much. So it is scientifically discredited to tell the same reasons even today, that the dams are only for the drinking water or for the agricultural purposes. So we have to do some other alternative mechanisms, like treating of water, reusing of water, or cleaning of water or something. So in order to tackle, or in order to curb the dependency of the dams. So since 1947 onwards, we are nearly having 4,700 large dams being built all across the country. And these dams have stored nearly millions of tons of fresh water by means of reservoirs. But what are the major concerns about these dams in the sense? The first major concern is, to solve the water crisis, large storage like these dams or the reservoirs is not the only option. We are having a lot of technological innovations, we are having a lot of treatment of water process, etc. So we have to look that instead of depending on this. And if you see, this much amount of water is getting stored, right? But in that, only a fraction of the water is used for the household sectors, and remaining 85% of the water is used only for producing cash crops such as sugarcane, etc. So in the sense, we are not utilizing what it actually meant for. We are turning the usage towards the economic purposes, not for the welfare purposes. Another major concern here is, by means of, or by the name of, construction of dams, they are actually destroying a lot of forests, villages and farms, and also they are destroying a lot of livelihoods. And by means of the same construction of dam, 4.4 million people are getting displaced from their own places or from their indigenous places. And the major, most important concern here is, these kind of construction of dams or the reservoirs can trigger the seismic events. So this is termed as reservoir induced seismicity. And so whatever the earthquakes or the natural calamities which is occurring due to these construction of reservoirs, nearly 17 out of the 75 calamities occur in India itself. So that much heavy impact the dam construction has in every country all over the world. And what is the way forward here is, There is a greater urgency to review the India's policy on the dams. We should look forward the policy. We have to efficiently implement this policies, etc. And instead of depending on the dam, we have to do some other alternatives like water recycling and reuse of the water, etc. And there should be a decentralized alternatives, which means everything should be tackled locally instead of phasing it at the central level or at the state level. We should go to the grassroots level or at the local level in order to make this more efficient. So we should critically review every dam in the country. That is the need of the hour. We should have some sound safety protocols for the maintenance of the dam, as well as we have to take care of the dams which are already built. Instead of building new dams, we have to make sure that the existing dams are functioning efficiently. So that is the need of the hour. So if you see here, the Sardar Sarovar and the Narmada Sagar Dam, which is built on top of Narmada River. So it is an example. So the next article is new copters to enable technology transfer. So we all knew about this strategic partnership policy, so SP model. So this SP model, what it means is it intended to promote the Indian private sector participation in the defense manufacturing. So before, in defense manufacturing, the equipments are manufactured by means of the involvement of DPSUs, which means the defense public sector undertakings. Only this DPSUs is taken care of the defense manufacturing, but now it is getting transferred to the private companies. So what the private company is now going to do is it is going to collaborate with OEMs, which are the original equipment manufacturers. So the private companies as well as the global original equipment manufacturers of foreign countries are working in collaboration to devise a plan as well as to get the technology from them. So our private countries will go to the foreign countries and foreign companies and get the technology transfer, and they again come here and make use of that technology. They are going to manufacture the defense equipment. So that is the plan under this SP model, and it is came into effect on May 31st, 2017, and it enables it is also a part of the Make in India campaign in defense sector. So we are actually aiming at Make in India. So it is also boosting that Make in India. And this policy also acknowledges one major thing, that the private sectors are usually having very limited experience in terms of this defense manufacturing. But even though they are having more efficiency, so we should make use of this opportunity in order to make our defense manufacturing to a greater level or to the next level. This is what the policy suggests. And this mainly aimed at four defense equipment manufacturing for these items. One is the fighter aircraft, another one is the helicopters and submarines, as well as the armored fighting vehicles or the main battle tanks. So the next article is delays plague projects, which despite of RERA, which means there are nearly lot of projects worth of $47 billion is now getting stalled all over the country, especially in Mumbai and in Delhi. Why? Because of financial constraints as well as the execution challenges which is faced by those developers of the projects or the constructors of the project. So why? Because the lack of funds is a big reason why the projects are getting stuck, and the developers of the project is also looking for some partner to come and invest some capital in order to complete the project, because the balance sheet of the developer of the project is now not that much efficient, or it is not supporting for further funding or for getting further funding from the financial institution. The balance sheet is not valid. They are already having a lot of debt, so they are obviously turning their focus towards the new investors or the new partners who are come and give some capital in order to resume the project. So this is one of the major concerns why all over the country lot of real estate projects are getting stuck. So that in order to make it efficient, the RERA 2016 came into force. So this have certain provisions which in order to improve the efficiency of the real estate projects. The one is RERA actually enforces some stricter norms on the developers. That is, you should finish this on time and you have to make use of this. And so they are putting some restrictions on the developers. And the RERA also protect the consumer's interest or the home buyers who are getting from the developers. So in order to protect them also, they are having certain provisions. And to boost the investment in the real estate sectors, as well as this RERA acts as an adjudicating body or a court kind of a thing for speedy dispute redressal mechanism. So if any dispute arises between the consumers as well as the developers, then this RERA acts as an adjudicating body to solve the issue. So what is the way forward here is, the RERA should ask the developer to give some complete deadline on where the project should be finished, or else it should give the deadline for those project or the developers, and it should make sure that the stalled projects are getting completed in a faster way. So these are the number of projects which are getting stalled in each and every region of our country. So the next article is ILO, which is the International Labour Organization. So this released a report which is Indian Wage Report, and in that report what they are stating is, if a state is getting economically developed, it doesn't mean that it is getting translated to higher wages for the workers in that state or in that country. So that is what they stated, which means economic development of a state doesn't indicate that the workers there are getting higher wages. So how they are stating here is, if you see in this picture, the average daily wage of a worker is like nearly 92% increase from 1994 level, which means in 1994 the worker can get 128 rupees per day, but now they are getting nearly like 250 rupees per day. So it is actually increasing. But though the average daily wage of the workers are getting increased, the wage inequality and the low pay for the workers are still remains constant. So this is what the major concern which is put forward by the ILO in that Indian wage report. So average daily wage is getting doubled, though low pay and wage inequality remains in our country. So how they are stating this is, if you see, there are two major imbalances in our country. One is the urban-rural divide as well as the gender gap. So in terms of urban-rural divide means, even today, an urban worker is earning double the time of a rural worker. So if a rural worker get 100 rupees, an urban worker get 200 rupees in 1994. But now, the rural worker can get up to 200 rupees, but similarly, the urban worker is also getting 400 rupees. So he is also getting doubled, and the urban worker is twice that of the rural worker. So this divide is always a consistently maintained one. So it is also a major concern which is put forward by ILO. As well as in terms of gender gap, the difference between the daily wage of a men and the women is, though it is consistently increasing, before it is like 48% wage gap between men and women, and now it is reduced to 34%. Okay, so it is now getting reduced. But if you see on the global average level, the daily wage difference between men and women is like only 23%, but we are 34%. So we have to still have to go forward in order to achieve at least that level, and then we have to try to eradicate the wage difference between the men and the women. So the last article is Article 35A and the basic structure of the Constitution. So what the question here is, can we able to strike down this Article 35A? And if it is possible, then whether we should strike down this Article 35A or not. So this is what a question which is recently rising. Why? Because the NGO which names We the Citizens, they filed a petition stating that Article 35A, which giving special privileges to Jammu and Kashmir. So that Article 35A is discriminatory as well as unconstitutional. So now we are going to see what is the background of this Article 35A. So in 1954, a presidential order was passed under Article 370, and this actually empowers or giving special status to Jammu and Kashmir, and in that only an Article 35A was inserted into the Constitution. So this Article 35A empowers the Jammu and Kashmir state legislatures to define the persons who are the permanent residents of Jammu and Kashmir and who are not the persons of the Jammu and Kashmir or who are the outsiders. So this have that much empowerment by means of this Article 35A. So the permanent residents are defined by the J&K state legislatures. And also this article allows the government to confer certain kind of special privileges and rights to that permanent residents in terms of employment, property, settlement, and as well as the scholarships or aids which is provided by the state government. So these are all the things which is only provided to the permanent residents and not to the outsiders of the Jammu and Kashmir. So this is what the Article 35A upholds. And one more important thing to note here is, this exempt such legislation from being annulled on the ground that they infringe one or other of the fundamental rights of the Constitution. So, which means if any law is getting enacted and that law infringes on the fundamental rights of the Constitution or the fundamental rights of the citizen, then the judiciary come and intervene and and check whether it is infringing on the constitutional rights of the citizens or not. If it is actually infringing, then the judicial review can strike down, the judiciary can strike down that law or the legislation itself. But that is not applicable to this Article 35A, which means on the name that you are infringing the fundamental rights of the constitution or certain provisions of the constitution, you couldn't be able to strike down this Article 35A. It is an extra power to that article. So that is also stated in that Article 370 itself. And one more thing is, this Article 35A is not amenable to a conventional basic structure. We all know that basic structure of the constitution. So the if anything is under that basic structure, then the judiciary can come and review that laws. So that is what the basic structure of the constitution. But this is not under the ambit of that basic structure itself. So it is also one more thing, because this it is already a well settled law. So one more thing is, Lewis Tillin, who is a political scientist, he stated about the Indian constitution, like, Indian constitution establishes an asymmetric federalism, which means it is not symmetric federalism, it is asymmetric, which is inequality in the federalism. There is center and there are states, but there is asymmetricity in the power which is given to each and every state. Not all the states are enjoying the equal power or same power. Some states enjoy greater autonomy over the governance than some other states. In this case, Jammu and Kashmir is having special status when compared to other states. So it is an asymmetric federalism. Similarly, the constitutional provisions which are governing the certain states, it is not applicable to Jammu and Kashmir. So those provisions are only for other states and not for Jammu and Kashmir. This is what he actually mentioned as asymmetric federalism, which is existing in our country. Jammu and Kashmir is having a legal document, which is Instrument of Accession. So this Instrument of Accession 1947 document stated certain provisions, like, if the parliament or center wants to do or enact any law over the Jammu and Kashmir, it is only possible in case of three things. One is the defense, foreign affairs, as well as the communications. In these three areas only, the parliament is having the power to legislate in case of Jammu and Kashmir. And if it wants to enact law on other areas apart from this, if in other areas, it should be only done by means of presidential order. So only after getting presidential order and the prior concurrence of the state government, if the Jammu and Kashmir is accepting that, then only the parliament can make laws on other areas except these three. So this Article 368 deals with the amendment of the constitution. So if you are going to amend the constitution, then the amendment is applicable to all the states. But in case of Jammu and Kashmir, it is not applicable. Whatever you are doing under Article 368, it is not applicable to J&K. Only if you want to do that, then you have to come through this Article 370. So if any specific order or amendment is made, then only you have to come through this Article 370 in case of Jammu and Kashmir, because similar to Article 368, Article 370 is also as much as part of the constitution. Both are the part of the constitution, so we shouldn't put one thing over the advantage of another thing. Both are similar and both are equal. Take this cases as examples. One is the Premnath Kaul case as well as the Sampath Prakash case. In these two cases, the Supreme Court again upholds that Article 370, which is giving special status to Jammu and Kashmir, it never ceased to be operative. It is always active. So that is what the Supreme Court stated. And you see here the Sankari Prasad case, Golaknath case, Keshwananda Bharti case, as well as this Minerva Mills case. So all these cases defines what the basic structure of the constitution is actually is. Similarly, we are having schedules. In that, the 9th schedule, which is, if you are going to put some laws or legislation in this 9th schedule, then it is not under the ambit of judicial review. So if you put something in 9th schedule, it is not reviewed by the judiciary before Keshavananta Bharti case. So before 1973, it is valid. But now, if you put anything under schedule 9, it is again come into the purview of judicial review. So that is what after upheld by the Keshavananta Bharti case by the Supreme Court. So what is the way forward here is, it is very much essential to maintain India's federal structure, as well as this Article 370, which is giving special status to Jammu and Kashmir. It is not like it is putting Jammu and Kashmir at an advantageous position. Rather, it should be treated as a tunnel to reach Jammu and Kashmir. So whatever the provisions or whatever the policies that the center is wanted to implement all over the country, they can make use of this Article 370 as a tunnel to reach Jammu and Kashmir and make it much more efficient and functioning. Thank you.